Australians have $3.3 trillion invested in superannuation, and where it's going might surprise you. A new report out from the Australia Institute and the Quit Nukes campaign looks at superannuation funds' exposure to nuclear weapons producers, finding that in many cases, your money might be going to support the creation of nuclear weapons. I'm Bill Brown, senior researcher at the Australia Institute's Democracy and Accountability Program, and I'm joined by Jem Remuld. Jem's the director of the International Campaign Against Nuclear Weapons Australia, or ICAN Australia for short, and a co-director of the Quit Nukes campaign. So Jem, thank you for joining us. Could you tell us a little bit about what the report has found?
Thanks so much, Bill. Thanks for having me and for teaming up with Quit Nukes on this important project. So we have been, Quit Nukes, that is, has been engaging with funds for about 2 years now, meeting with a number of them and talking to them about their nuclear weapons investments. And we realised it was time to do the research into their investments in nuclear weapons companies and to share what we found with the public. So we teamed up with the Australia Institute to write this report. We picked a selection of the top Australian funds. So there are 22 institutions that we look at in this report. And on the whole, they cover about 80% of superannuation funds under management across Australia. So it's really good coverage. And then we methodically went through all of their statements, their policies, their disclosures to see what they're invested in, looking at product disclosure statements, the fine print, as well as what the websites say and anything that's publicly available, as well as proxy voting records. So that allowed us to see in a number of places where funds were invested in nuclear weapons companies, but it doesn't allow us to see the amount. A few of them, a very small number, disclosed a lot, but on the whole, there's not a lot of disclosure. We did find that most major Australian superannuation funds do invest in nuclear weapons companies, but they're not at all clear about this. Of the 22 institutions we looked at, we found that 18 had holdings, 2 didn't, and 2 didn't disclose anything at all. So, in fact, many of them give the impression quite strongly that they don't invest in nuclear weapons. So, for example, if a fund says that they won't invest in controversial weapons, you would expect that that would include nuclear weapons, but often it doesn't.
So if I understand you right, Australians don't have a right to know what their own superannuation fund is investing their money in?
No, not currently, but that's all changing from March 2022 because legislation has passed to require all funds to disclose the identity, value and weightings of their investments from the 31st of March onwards and every 6 months. So this will be a real game changer for responsible investment, and it will force funds to be much more honest about what they are and what they are not willing to invest in. For this report, however, we've seen really differing levels of disclosure. We were able to find detailed holdings information for Australian Super, Colonial, First State and Energy Super. Some others disclose the top 20 or 50 holdings, or some none at all. But as I said, the proxy voting records were very helpful. So we've got a picture at least of the minimum of what funds are invested in, but it's possible that there are many more investments that we weren't able to discover. But of course, we'll be able to find that out next March when they're required to disclose. So at the end of the day, currently, most Australians would have no idea whether their money is being invested in nuclear weapons or not. And the chances are that it is.
To back up the report, the Australia Institute, in consultation with Quit Nukes, did some polling research of its own to find out exactly what Australians think about superannuation and nuclear weapons. And the results, I think, really back up what you're saying. 7 in 10 Australians don't want their superannuation invested in nuclear weapons companies. And what's more, 4 in 5, or 78%, think that at the very least their superannuation fund should tell them if they're investing in nuclear weapons. So there's overwhelming support among superannuation customers for this kind of information to be public, and what's more, for superannuation funds to divest.
Yeah, and I think that really does put a fire under what this report says and what it shows. There is a clear disconnect between the impression that funds are giving of their investments and their responsible investment policies and what they're actually doing. So we'll see websites with wonderful statements and nice pictures, but if you dig deeper, then most of these funds are invested in companies that produce nuclear weapons, these weapons of mass destruction. And the reality is that most superannuation members will not have the time or the knowledge or the inclination to dig through the statements in detail. It's just not realistic. So it does seem like funds are misrepresenting what they're invested in, and that's to the detriment of consumers. So with controversial weapons, many of these funds do have policies that exclude controversial weapons, which is excellent, but many of them do not include nuclear weapons as part of their definition. So some funds will even say that their definition of a controversial weapon is one that is subject to an international treaty. So you would think that that would include nuclear weapons now, especially since the entry into force of the nuclear weapon ban treaty, but they are still investing in nuclear weapons. So we hope that, you know, there are really compelling reasons for them to change and that their members will push for change as well. For other funds, they would say that they don't invest in controversial weapons, but there will be a revenue threshold. So they'll deem it acceptable to invest in a company if it's only a certain percentage of revenue that they're gaining from these weapons.
We tested this question as well with the Australian public, asking them to classify different types of weapon as whether they'd expect them to qualify as controversial or not. And we find 69%, 7 in 10 Australians, expect nuclear weapons to be included as a controversial weapon, which given the course of human history, I think makes a lot of sense. Only 10% thought explicitly that they shouldn't be included in a controversial weapons definition, and the remainder is people who don't know or aren't sure. So again, you've got 7 in 10 Australians who are going to look at a website that says that a superannuation fund is outside of controversial weapons, and they're going to assume that that means they're not going to have their money invested in nuclear weapons, and sometimes they'll be wrong.
Yeah, you're right about that, Bill. And I think it is common sense that to think of nuclear weapons as controversial weapons. So, you know, we're seeing increasing pressure on super funds, wealth funds and the finance sector generally to divest from companies involved in nuclear weapons, especially since January this year when the UN Treaty on the Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons entered into force. And that says that nuclear weapons are now illegal under international law, along with cluster munitions, chemical weapons, biological weapons, and landmines. So since that treaty was negotiated a few years ago, we've seen overseas a number of institutions respond to that and specifically cite the treaty as their reason for change. So that includes the Norwegian Sovereign Wealth Fund, which is the largest sovereign wealth fund in the world, and the largest Dutch pension fund, dozens of Japanese banks, and many others that we look at in our report. And we're really also pleased to see that just in the last month, the Responsible Investment Association of Australasia has announced that they are changing their definition of controversial weapons to include nuclear weapons as of January next year. So any of their certified products that have that stamp for responsible investment will have to be nuclear weapons free.
So you mentioned the treaty has come into force this year. It must have a fair bit of international support. Is Australia a signatory?
Not yet, Bill, and it's been a problem so far. Our government has been on the wrong side of history. We haven't participated in the negotiations and we haven't yet signed or ratified. But pressure for that to change is also mounting. Separate polling that we've done shows that 8 out of 10 Australians want our government to sign and ratify this treaty. And we do have a federal opposition that has a policy commitment. Labor has committed to sign and ratify the treaty in government. So we know that Australia will have to join this treaty eventually, just as we've joined all the treaties that prohibit other abhorrent weapons, but it hasn't happened yet, and we want to make it happen as soon as possible. But even before that, there are some really compelling reasons for financial institutions to actually be out front and leading the way on this issue. So, you know, of course, there are the humanitarian and environmental arguments These weapons are indiscriminate, inhumane, and abhorrent. There's no legitimate role for nuclear weapons in our world, and so there's also no legitimate reason to support their manufacture. Even if the companies spend a lot more of their time on other business, there should be direct financial pressure on them to end their specific work on nuclear weapons. So also across the sector, Bill, we see that, you know, there's big money invested in nuclear weapons, but these investments are usually a very tiny percentage of funds under management for each individual fund. So divesting will have no impact on returns, and that's a really important point, and it's a small number of companies that we're talking about. So our report also shows that indices that exclude nuclear weapons companies, such as one from MSCI and one from FTSE, perform even better than their parent indices that don't contain these exclusions. So nuclear weapons are illegal, and this presents a risk for investors as more nations join this treaty and the pressure to divest will only increase.
And it's not all doom and gloom in the Australian superannuation sector. The report identifies six superannuation funds that are already divested from nuclear weapons: Active Super, Australian Ethical, Christian Super, Crescent Wealth, Future Super, and Verve Super. So Australians already have options for putting their superannuation funds into investments that won't be involved in the production of nuclear weapons.
Yeah, that's right, Bill. There are a number that are leading the way. And even since we've been writing this report, we've had some great news. We've had a commitment from Host Plus that they will divest from nuclear weapons companies as of January 2022. So they've decided to include nuclear weapons in their definition of controversial weapons, which means that they'll be excluded across all of their portfolios. We've also heard from Care Super that they have now divested from the two nuclear weapons holdings that we found, but we need them to do more and to implement a clear policy to prevent any future nuclear weapons investments. So it won't, you know, it's possible, it's feasible, and it won't take much for Australian super funds to start doing the right thing. They need to improve transparency. We're looking forward to that next year. They need to include nuclear weapons companies, nuclear weapons as part of their definition of controversial weapons for exclusion across all portfolios with a 0% revenue threshold. And they also need to divest from any current holdings that they have. And you know, this will make a meaningful difference for fund members and for our efforts more broadly across Australia to end nuclear weapons.
All right, well, thank you so much, Shem, and for the collaboration of the Australia Institute. We've produced, I think, a really excellent report, and it's one that viewers can check out for themselves on either organisation's website, so australiainstitute.org.au or quitnukes.org, available for free download. Thanks again, Jem.
Thanks so much, Bill. Great to talk.
The bottom 20% get nothing. They're really unfair tax cuts.
People want to see much stronger action from the government when it comes to climate change.
It's no coincidence that we have a wages crisis in Australia.
Transitioning to net zero emissions, it doesn't seem like there's much room for gas.